Where we left off was just introducing the eukaryotic cell cycle and pointing out that it is divided into several phases, three of which are lumped together into a grouping we call interphase, which includes a gap in which the primary growth phase of the cell occurs. This usually is the longest phase of the cell cycle. The S phase, in which replication of DNA takes place. S stands for synthesis, so it is here that replication of DNA takes place. And gap two, in which the organelles are replicating and the microtubules are beginning to organize into what will eventually be a mitotic spindle that will separate the chromatids in mitosis. And then mitosis proceeds, in which the chromosomes are partitioned to prospective daughter cells. And mitosis is actually divided into five different phases that we'll cover shortly. And then finally, cytokinesis, which is the cell division, the actual cell division, in which the plasma membrane or cell walls, if you're a plant, are pinched off or formed, and which divides the original parental cell into two daughter cells. And you can calculate what the different durations of these phases are. For example, let's look at mitosis. If we look at the duration of the cell cycle, there's actually quite a bit of variability across cell type in a given organism or across different organisms. For example, in fruit fly embryos, the nuclear divisions that take place early in embryogenesis only take 8 minutes. Very, very rapid cell division cycle in fruit fly embryos. And in embryos in general, the cell cycles tend to be shortened somewhat during the early stages of embryogenesis, in which masses of cells are being produced, which will later be morphed into embryonic form. Now, when in adults, mature cells take longer to grow. For example, a typical adult mammalian cell takes about 24 hours to complete a cell cycle. A liver is an exception. It takes more than a year to complete a cell cycle. Growth, as we've pointed out, occurs during all interphase stages. No growth takes place during the mitotic phase, and usually that takes about an hour in a eukaryotic cell. And when we talk about variation in the length of the cell cycle, we're mostly looking at the variation that takes place in the length of the G1 phase. Now, when cells exit the cell cycle, they stop dividing. They enter a phase which we call G0, or the resting phase. And cells can exit permanently from the cell cycle, never divide again, and enter into a permanent GO, or they can rest in GO and resume the cell cycle, start dividing later if the appropriate signals arise, and the cell will then respond by reinitiating the cell cycle. So the resting phase is GO, and that can be entered into or left, depending. Here's an example of a wonderful preparation of onion root tip, which stained for DNA in purple, allows you to recognize cells in different stages of the cell cycle. So for example, right here is a cell in metaphase of mitosis. Here's a cell in anaphase of mitosis. But most of the cells you will see are in interphase, in which the chromatin is diffuse and not condensed into chromosomes, as is the case with mitosis. So let's take a higher mag view of some of those. Here's a metaphase mitotic cell. Most of the cells, again, we can see are in interphase with the chromatin diffuse throughout the nucleus. Here's an even higher mag view. Here's an anaphase of mitosis. Here is interphase cell, interphase. This cell is in, looks like late anaphase. So you can take a preparation like this, or you could take a preparation of any organism cells grown in culture and stain those cells with a dye that binds to DNA and look at the percentage of cells that are in different stages of the cell cycle. So for example, if you were to take a culture of human cells grown in culture with a cell cycle of about 24 hours, let's say, and you found that the percentage of cells that were in mitosis was approximately 4% of the cells, Well, then you can determine how long mitosis is going to last. It would be 0.04, 4% times 24 hours equals, or approximately equals, 1 hour. So by looking at the percentage of cells that are in a given phase of the cell cycle, you can, if you know the total length of the cell cycle, you can determine then the time it takes to complete any given given phase. Because on average, then, if the mitosis, for example, only took 1 hour out of 24, then approximately 4% of the cells would be in mitosis at any one time, like this cell at metaphase of mitosis, or this cell over here at anaphase of mitosis. So that's a nice way to calculate those things. Now, during interphase, the G1, S, and G2 phases, we've looked at what happens during those cells, those stages previously. And a point to emphasize here is that in the centromeric region of chromosomes, which is characterized by given DNA sequences, a kinetochore is assembled. And the kinetochore is a complex of proteins. So the kinetochore is a protein complex. Is a protein complex that assembles at the centromere. And it is to the kinetochore that microtubules attach. So if a chromosome, a replicated chromosome, looks like this, there are two kinetochores, one for each chromatid, and it is there that mitotic spindles attach, microtubules, which are part of the mitotic spindle, attach. So they attach at the kinetochores. And the chromatids are held together by cohesin, or a protein called cadensin in metazoans, that hold the chromatids together until they separate in anaphase of mitosis. So here is a schematic of the cell cycle. And we will talk about these restriction points, which represent points at which the cell is asking questions of itself. It's asking, as the cell proceeds through the cell cycle and on the route to cell division during cytokinesis, are things okay? For example, at the G1S checkpoint, this is called the start or the restriction point, the cell is asking itself, am I ready to synthesize new DNA? Is my DNA intact? Has it been damaged in any way? If so, I should stop here and not begin synthesis of my DNA, replicating my DNA in preparation for mitosis. Likewise, at the G2 mitosis checkpoint, the cell is asking itself, molecularly speaking, of course, am I ready to enter mitosis and condense my chromosomes and separate them? Has there been damage to my DNA? Is everything okay? And at the spindle checkpoint, this is kind of the anaphase checkpoint, it's asking, have all my chromatids been attached to microtubules in preparation for segregation of chromatids to opposite poles of the cell, which will enable cytokinesis to partition the genetic material into equal parts to two daughter cells? So this is spindle checkpoint asks whether we're ready to separate the chromatids. So then let's look at this, the molecular mechanisms in at least superficial detail that control the progression of the cell cycle through these various checkpoints. And let's make sure we have some terminology down first before we go forward. And the main one you need to know, of course, is that what kinase enzymes do. Kinase enzymes catalyze the reaction of taking a target protein plus ATP and taking one of the phosphate groups from ATP and phosphorylating target residues on the target protein. If it's a serine threonine kinase, then it attaches phosphates to serine or threonine amino acids on the target protein. If it's a tyrosine kinase, then it attaches the phosphate to tyrosine amino acids on the target protein. We've covered this already in terms of cell signaling, but I think it's very important that you remember that kinases are enzymes that phosphorylate target proteins. And so let's look at our molecular players here. One of our molecular players, you will see, are CDKs, and they have different numbers, CDK2, CDK4, CDK1, CDK2. And these CDKs are cyclin-dependent kinases. And as the name implies, they are kinase enzymes that phosphorylate target enzymes, but they are dependent upon another protein called cyclin. And just as there are different cyclin-dependent kinases, there are also different cyclins: cyclin D, cyclin E, cyclin A, cyclin B. And these cyclins are proteins that are, as their name implies, these proteins are synthesized and degraded at various points during the cell cycle. So unlike most proteins, which might have a fairly long half-life in the cell, cyclins have very short half-lives. They exist transiently throughout the cell cycle. And we'll look at the synthesis of cyclins shortly, but just remember that they're present only in for short times during the cell cycle. And if that's true, then their cyclin-dependent kinases are only active during certain parts of the cell cycle, because after all, these cyclin-dependent kinases, are dependent on the presence of their respective cyclins. So these cyclin-dependent kinases are only active and can only phosphorylate proteins during certain stages of the cell cycle when their corresponding cyclin is present, because they are dependent upon binding to cyclin for their activity. Now, another player, retinoblastoma protein. Retinoblastoma protein, as we'll see, is a key regulator of whether or not the cell will progress to the S phase from the G1 phase. And it is therefore a regulator at this restriction point, the G1S restriction point, which determines whether the cell will continue through the cell cycle. And excuse me. Another player is the E2F transcription factor, which turns on genes that are needed for progression through the cell cycle and cell division. So think of active E2F as being a transcription factor that will cause the expression of genes, the transcription of genes that will drive the cell through the cell cycle, that is, cell division genes. And E2F can be either an active free form in which it can activate genes, or it can be bound to the retinoblastoma protein. So this is where we're going to pick up with in the next part of this lecture, but keep the key players in mind here: cyclin-dependent kinases, cyclins, retinoblastoma, and E2F. And we'll get into P21 a little bit in the next section as well.